क्या है। सो रेस्पेक्टेड सीनियर्स एंड ऑन माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, वेरी वार्म गुड आफ्टरनून टू यू ऑल। टुडे वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग ब्रीफली अबाउट पेटेंट डक्टस आर्टेरियोसिस, पर्टिकुलरली द पीडीए कंसर्न्ड विद प्रीटर्म इन्फेंट्स। सो
You have become muted.
Yeah. Okay. Now we'll just proceed with the case. So this is a baby of R, born at 27 weeks of gestation with birth weight of 920 gram. Currently on a CPAP support of a 5 centimeter pressures and 21% FiO2. On day 5 of life, the baby was detected to have white pulse pressure as well as an easily palpable dorsalis pedis pulse. So an echocardiography was done simultaneously, which showed a 3 millimeter PDA with left right shunt with LA by AO ratio of 2.1, E by A ratio of more than 1, and IVRP of 28. So we'll discuss the echo parameters in the subsequently. So we have a case at 27 week old 920 gram baby who's on CPAP. On suddenly on day 5, the resident noticed to have white pulse pressure as well as easily palpable dorsalis pedis pulse. So the most common cause for such a scenario is that a normally baby who is on CPAP without any FIO2 requirement suddenly starting detected to have a white pulse pressure and easily palpable dorsalis pedis. The most common differential diagnosis, or the first differential diagnosis, is patent ductus arteriosus. So why should we discuss PDA? Essentially, there is a large body of basic science as well as clinical research on PDA, and there is actually clinical experience with thousands of infants over nearly 6 decades, and still there is uncertainty and controversy about the significance, evaluation and management of PDA in preterm infants. So there is a wide substantial heterogeneity in clinical practice regarding the management and also whether to treat or not a PDA. So our discussion topic will be focusing on anatomy and spontaneous closure of PDA and the factors affecting it, hemodynamic effects of PDA, echocardiographic screening and its role, a brief about PDA severity score and the role of biomarkers in PDA, and whether it is necessary to treat a PDA in a preterm baby really, and if you decide to treat, what are the available options you have, pharmaceutical drugs, and regarding surgical ligation, is it still an option, and also a brief on non-pharmacological interventions in case of PDA. So I'll begin with fetal circulation. So as you all know, in a fetus you have essentially 3 shunts. That is, first one is your ductus venosus, which helps to bypass the blood flow coming from the placenta and essentially goes directly to the IVC. Second, you have the foramen ovale. So the oxygenated blood from the placenta, after entering IVC RA, majority, that is approximately 2/3, gets shunted to the left atrium, then to left ventricle, and through the aorta it supplies mainly the cerebral circulation. So this is the second shunt, is your foramen ovale. And third shunt is you have ductus arteriosus. So it is essentially a physiological conduit which is present, which is necessary for the normal fetal survival. So what happens is that 2/3 of the blood gets shunted to the LA, the remaining 1/3 gets shunted to the RV and through the pulmonary artery. And in the pulmonary artery, in fetal life, the pulmonary PVR is actually very high, and there is essentially, there is no circulation going to the lungs. So what happens is that the majority of the blood, it gets shunted through the ductus arteriosus, from the PA to the descending aorta, and it supplies the lower limbs. So what is this ductus arteriosus? It's actually, it originates from the, it is a connection between pulmonary artery and aorta, and it usually originates from the left pulmonary artery and joins the aorta. And it is actually as you all know, this is the embryological arches, this is a paired dorsal arches, there are 6 in number. And ductus arteriosus, it is the remnant of the left distal part of the left 6th arch which give rise to the ductus arteriosus. So what happens normally, so in a normal newborn, the ductus closes off spontaneously. So as you can see, in case of term newborns, by day 4 of life itself, 100% of cases there will be no ductus arteriosus, which is patent, it has closed off spontaneously. Same at day 7 and at discharge, there is no duct. What about more than or equal to 30 weeks gestation babies? Here you can see that by day 4, 90% of cases, again, it closes spontaneously, and by discharge, 98% of PDA closes spontaneously. So more than or equal to 30 weeks of gestation, PDA doesn't cause much trouble. Now, what about the lower gestation? So as you can see from the graph, the main focus of our target is the 28 to 29, 26 to 27, and the 24 to 25 weeker. So less than 30 weeks, as you can see, in case of 28 to 29, by day 4, 45% is only closed. And it comes down even to 4% in case of 24 to 25 weeker. And you can see that by discharge also, approximately half of the babies born 24 to 25 weeks, the ductus will be still patent. So there comes the role of why we need to study about this PDA. So you have to remember that in preterm babies, PDA closure is delayed. And in less than 28 weeks, ductus is open in 85% of babies on day 4. And by 70%, it is open by day 7. So, but what is the other side? Even in the most immature infants, spontaneous closure of PDA does occur. So it is not necessary that you have to treat every PDA in a less than 30 week. You give time, and by natural course, there is spontaneous closure which is occurring. So the normal ductal closure, it occurs in two stages. So there is a first stage of functional or reversible closure. And the second, you have this anatomic or the irreversible closure. So the functional closure, it occurs within 10 to 15 hours of birth in a term neonate. Whereas this anatomical closure, it takes some time, approximately 2 to 3 weeks, wherein there will be muscle media hypoxia, then proliferation, and subsequently it is closed off. We'll be discussing the pathophysiology subsequently. So there is a functional or an reversible closure which occurs within 10 to 15 hours. And then you have this anatomic or the irreversible closure, which is completed by 2 to 3 weeks, in case of, particularly in case of a term neonate. Now, what regulates this ductus patency? So as you all know, in fetal life, it is a physiological conduit. After birth, once the baby is born, it starts closing off. So what regulates the closure as well as the patency of the duct? So there exists a delicate balance between the vasoconstrictive factors, or the factors which promote ductus to close, and the vasorelaxation factors, or the factors which keep the ductus patent. So what are the factors which promote vasoconstriction? So as soon as the baby breathes, what happens? Oxygen is taken in. So the oxygen is the potent vasoconstrictor. So the other mediators are endothelin, calcium, catecholamines, and rho kinase, of which the most important thing is the birth of the baby and intake of oxygen. What about the factors which oppose vasoconstriction? This is the factors which maintain the ductus patent in the fetal life. So naturally in the fetal life, there will be one thing is that the intraluminal pressure, which will be very high because you have blood flow which is going from the PA to aorta. So there exists an intraluminal pressure, one thing. Second, the most important mediator is prostaglandin E2. So prostaglandin E2, the circulating levels of prostaglandin E2 is very high in the fetal life. So the most important mediator which keeps the ductus patent is prostaglandin E2. So the treatment of PDA is also based on this concept. So you target prostaglandin and you try to close the duct. The other mediators are nitric oxide, carbon monoxide, potassium channels, cyclic AMP, and cyclic GMP. So we have a host of factors which favor vasoconstriction or the closure of the ductus, and a host of factors which causes the ductus to appear patent, of which the major players are oxygen endothelin in case of closure, and in case of dilation, the major player is prostaglandin E2. Now, what happens in utero? In utero, as I've already said, there will be the intraluminal pressure will be very much elevated. The prostaglandin E2, the ductus smooth muscle is extraordinarily sensitive to prostaglandin E2. So what's the role of prostaglandin E2? To cause vasodilatation. And the receptors also, the PGE2 acts on receptors EP2, EP3, EP4. These receptors are also found in increased concentration in the ductus in the fetal life. And what they cause? They cause vasodilatation by activating the cyclic AMP or GMPs, adenylate cyclase. And also in the ductus itself, there will be locally produced PGE2 as well as PGE2 which is coming from the placenta. So the source of placenta, PGE2 is either placenta or the PGE2 which is locally produced in the ductus. The smooth muscle is sensitive to that PGE2 and it acts by causing vasodilatation. This is the thing which happens in fetal life. And it is necessary for the ductus to be kept open in the fetal life so that it is essential for fetal survival. So in fetal life, what is PDA? This is a physiological conduit which is necessary to for maintenance of normal fetal life. Now, postnatally, what happens? The PaO2 increases. The ductal, as soon as baby takes place birth, the majority of the blood flow, what happens? The PVR comes down. The lungs, which have been vasoconstricted, the PVR comes down. So the blood flow immediately gets shifted to the lungs. The amount of blood which is flowing through the ductus comes down. So the ductal luminal blood pressure will come down. You have cut the placenta, so there will be no placental production of PGE2. And again, the PGE2 which is there also, it will be increasingly removed by the lung. And prior to birth, the PGE2 receptors were in abundance and the ductus smooth muscle was very much sensitive to that PGE2. But after birth, there is decrease in receptors as well as decrease in sensitivity to the action of PGE2. All this, ultimately what happens? Functional closure takes place within 15 to 18 hours and later anatomic closure. So what is the difference between preterm and term ductus? So in case of term ductus, within 15 to 18 hours, you have functional closure. Within 3 weeks, you have anatomic closure. The story is done and dusted. You don't have any issue. But what happens in preterm? So in case of preterms, there are some physiological handicaps, the preterm. Like we say for every disease in preterm, preterms have some physiological handicap because of their prematurity. So a baby who is born less than 30 weeks, his smooth muscle isoforms will be immature. The tone of the smooth muscle will be less. Calcium, again, the factors which favor constriction is calcium. So there will be decreased calcium entry through calcium channels. And there will be increased potassium channels which are not regulated by oxygen. So how does oxygen cause constriction? It acts it causes constriction by acting on the potassium channels. But in preterms, the channels are not regulated by oxygen, which is present in abundance. Also, there is decreased endothelin production. There is decreased pulmonary clearance by the circulating prostaglandin E2. And also, there is increased number of receptors. So all the points which we told about favoring closure, like decrease in PGE2, the removal of PGE2 by the lungs, the removal of the decrease in production of PGE2 by the placenta, the tone is decreased. So all these factors are not present fully in case of a preterm. And that is the reason why the preterm ductus remains patent. So the preterm infants, they have an elevated circulating concentration of PGE2. And it's partly due to the decreased ability of the premature lung to clear this circulating PGE2. So the circulating levels are high because the clearance is low. And the most important mechanism that prevents the preterm ductus from constricting its birth is its increased sensitivity to the vasodilatory effect of PGE2. So we treat PDA by targeting prostaglandin. So normally prostaglandin after birth, it takes a back seat and oxygen comes in the front seat and it causes constriction. In case of preterm, this PGE2, it is still acting on the smooth muscle and it is increasingly present in the circulation. So this is in with regard to the functional closure. Now we discussed that anatomical closure, it occurs approximately by 2 to 3 weeks. So how does anatomical closure occurs? So there are two mechanisms have been proposed for anatomical closure. First thing is intimal thickening. So the smooth muscle of the PDA, as you remember from a UG days, what are the smooth muscle wall? You can divide it into tunica, intima, and the intima, media, adventitia. So what happens is that in anatomical closure, the smooth muscles which are present from the media, they migrate to the intima. And in the lumen, there is proliferation of endothelial cells. So one thing is intimal thickening. Second, what happens? I told that the blood flow through the ductus comes down. So after birth, the majority of the blood flow is going to the lungs. The flow which is happening through the ductus is less. So the nutrition to the ductus comes from where? The blood which is flowing through the lumen. So when blood flow is less, the nutrition is less, and what happens is hypoxia. So what hypoxia, what does it cause? It causes anoxia, apoptosis, and necrosis. And also what happens is that as the ductus constricts, So as the ductus constricts, what happens is that the flow decreases. The monocytes which are present in the blood, they adhere to the endothelium and they cause secretion of platelet-derived growth factors. And what happens is it's smooth, coupled with the smooth muscle migrates from the media to the intima. Also, hypoxia is a potent stimulator of VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor. So together with smooth muscle migration, as well as endothelial proliferation, there is formation of intimal mounds, neo-intimal mounds, and which occlude the lumen permanently. So this is how the anatomic closure occurs, by the formation of neo-intimal mound. And the major, what causes this anatomic closure is constriction of the ductus, and the flow is negligible. This flow, when the flow is negligible, hypoxia ensues. And what does hypoxia cause? It stimulates growth factors, and which cause endothelial proliferation, and simultaneously there is migration of the smooth muscle from the media to the intima. Together they form a neo-intimal mound, and it causes occlusion of the lumen. So functional closure, constricting factors and dilating factors. After birth, the constricting factors take upper hand. After constriction, by 2 to 3 weeks, the flow decreases, hypoxia happens, there is proliferation of this wedges and everything, and simultaneously you have a formation of neo-intimal mound and anatomic closure happens. So in case of normally the pulmonary blood flow is equal to systemic blood flow, but what happens if the ductus is patent? After, from in the fetal life, the flow of the ductus was from pulmonary artery to aorta, that is from the right to the left. Why? PVR is high, SVR is low. After birth, what happens? You take breath, the pulmonary vessels dilate, PVR comes down. You clamp the cord, the umbilical artery is clamped. So what happens? SVR rises. So after birth, if the ductus is patent, where will be the direction of the flow? From left to right. So what happens? Increased QP compared to systemic flow. There will be increased pulmonary blood flow by, if the ductus is patent. So what are the clinical associations? Why we are worried about if the ductus is patent? So the main problem is that left to right flow, increased flooding of the pulmonary vessels. What happens if there is pulmonary hyperperfusion in case of preterm? And hemorrhage. So what are the clinical associations caused by this pulmonary hyperperfusion? Is pulmonary hemorrhage. And suppose if your baby is on ventilator, you intubated the baby, ventilated for RDS, and by day 3 the RDS improves and you are planning to extubate. Suddenly if the PDA is open, what happens? Again, there is left to right shunt, pulmonary hyperperfusion. So the prolonged ventilator dependency. Second, prolonged ventilator dependency, ultimately in the long run there is risk for BPD. And also, short term, it can even cause mortality. So this is the subsequent consequences of pulmonary hyperperfusion. Now, what are the consequences of systemic hyperperfusion? So your shunt is from left to right. You are flooding the pulmonary system. And simultaneously, what happens is that there is stealing of blood from the systemic circulation. That is what is called ductal steal. So what are the consequences of systemic hyperperfusion? The clinical association of systemic hyperperfusion are hypotension, necrotizing enterocolitis, because your splanchnic circulation is compromised. So the baby can go in for NEC, renal failure, intraventricular hemorrhage, PVL, and again mortality. So the pulmonary hyperperfusion as well as systemic hyperperfusion. These are the things which happen when you have a patent ductus, which is hemodynamically significant. So it is not necessary that every duct which is patent will lead to this. Large duct with significant left to right shunt can result in this pulmonary hyperperfusion as well as your systemic hyperperfusion. And you have echocardiographic parameters to detect this pulmonary hyperperfusion as well as the systemic hypoperfusion. So we'll be discussing in coming slides. So the echocardiography, why we are talking all the time about echo in case of PDA? We can monitor clinically also. What is the importance of echo in case of a preterm ductus? You can monitor clinically also. In pediatric babies, you don't do echo. You monitor clinically only. Na? Why echo is more important here in case of preterms? No, it's not that. The main thing is that the clinical symptoms takes time to develop. So by echocardiography, you can detect it 48 hours prior. So at two days or approximately 48 hours early, you can detect a hemodynamically significant PD and you can decide to treat. So that is why the role of echocardiography in assessing a ductus in case of preterm. So you can assess the pulmonary hyperperfusion as well as your systemic hyperperfusion. So we'll look at the patterns of presentation of PDA in premature infants. So first pattern of presentation is like PDA with little or no lung disease. This is classically you get to see in this more than 1500 gram babies. So what you can see that in these babies, you start hearing a murmur, systolic murmur, starting by roughly 24 to 72 hours of age, which becomes louder and longer as the shunt increases. And these babies typically do not develop CHF. And surgical closure, it is rarely indicated. In fact, even treatment medically is also rarely indicated. And if left alone, they close spontaneously by 2 to 3 months. So this is in a bigger premise. The PDA, which is more like a silent bystander, it is not causing much trouble. Now, what about the PDA in infants with recovering lung disease? So this is the most common group, our 1,000 to 1,500 gram babies. The baby had RDS, you gave surfactant, oxygenation improved. And what happens? Once the disease RDS improves, the PVR starts coming down. When PVR starts coming down, the shunt comes into play. So in these two type of babies, it can present with either with murmur. You can, in your daily clinical round, you can pick it up with murmur or hyperdynamic precordium. Or a baby, when you are planning to extubate, suddenly deteriorating. Deterioration of ventilatory status. And it may be associated with cardiomegaly or white pulse pressure on tracings. So in these type of babies, so particularly suppose someone asks you a differential diagnosis for a respiratory distress on day one, you don't comment about PDA. PDA typically starts playing once day 3 to day 5. That is a typical days when the PDA starts coming into play. So for day one respiratory distress, you don't give your first DDS, PDA. Once the RDS or whatever be the pathology, it is improving, you are trying to take the baby off ventilator. If the ductus is there, it can lead to worsening of the ventilatory status. This is the second presentation. And what about third presentation? These babies are less than 1,000 gram babies. This is the group of babies which have a very high incidence of PDA. So more than 1,500, not causing much trouble. You can leave it alone. 1,000 to 1,500, it can cause trouble once you're trying to wean off the baby. In case of less than 1,000 gram, these babies usually have severe lung disease, but anyway, they'll be on respiratory support. So in some cases, they may be silent, but majority of the cases, they show some evidence of left-right shunt. So sometimes you needn't do anything. It doesn't cause any trouble. If the baby improves on its own, you just have to monitor clinically only. But a large number of babies fail to improve or they get worsened on the ventilator. So this is the group of patients where you have to be extremely careful, the less than 1,000 gram babies. Now, we'll briefly discuss about the clinical signs of PDM. So anyone, what is the earliest sign of a ductus in a preterm unit? Earliest sign. Clinical sign, not echo. Sign. No.
Tachycardia.
Yeah. So Mujib has said it correctly. So the earliest sign is tachycardia. What about the most specific sign?
White pulse pressure.
No. So increased precordial pulsations. So some people combined with increased precordial pulsations say white pulse pressure also, but the combination of increased precordial pulsation as well as a white pulse pressure, that is the most specific sign. So what are the other signs, by the way? So one, we said tachycardia. Second, bounding pulses. So normally it is classically said that in a neonate, the dorsalis pedis pulse is just palpable. How do you say whether pulse is bounding or not? Not by looking at the radial. In a preterm neonate, the dorsalis pedis is just palpable. But if there is a PDA and you have a bounding pulse, the dorsalis pedis is well felt. That is the statement which is used. So well palpable dorsalis pedis indicates that your pulse is a bounding pulse. So you have tachycardia, bounding pulse. Third, I already said, increased precordial pulsations or the hyperdynamic precordium. Fourth, white pulse pressure. So how do you call it white pulse pressure? Define, Mujib, when do you say it is white pulse pressure? Okay, that's okay. That's bounding pulse. What about white pulse pressure? How do you define white pulse pressure?
More than
40. No, absolute difference of more than 25. An absolute difference between systolic and diastolic are more than 25, you call it white pulse pressure. Or other way, is there any other method to define white pulse pressure? Your diastolic pressure is how much more than systolic?
More than
half. More than half. So you have tachycardia, hyperdynamic precordia, increased precordial pulsations, void pulse pressure. These are all clinical signs. Suppose a baby who is on ventilator, you can have additional findings. What are they? Increased ventilatory requirement. Suppose a baby who is on suddenly FiO2 of maybe pressures of 14 by 5, FiO2 of 21 or 25%. Suddenly on fine morning on day 4, you notice that the FiO2 has gone up to 40 or 50%. So increased FiO2 requirement. Second, so you did a blood gas, increased acidosis. So mixed acidosis. You get both metabolic acidosis, respiratory acidosis because of systemic hyperperfusion as well as overcirculation. So on a ventilator baby, you have additionally increased ventilatory requirement or worsening of blood gases. Otherwise, in a stable baby, you can have increased precordial pulsation, tachycardia, white pulse pressure, easily palpable dorsalis pedis. So when do these clinical signs appear? So one of the consistently reported clinical findings associated with a large PD on day one is low BP. It's actually only on day one, usually you don't look for PDA, but one of the signs which is consistently reported associated with the PDA on day one is hypotension. And the characteristic murmur, which is a characteristic murmur of PDA you describe in older children? Continuous murmur. In neonates, you don't get this typical continuous murmur because of your... Why don't you get a continuous murmur?
Tachycardia.
No.
Pulmonary pressure is still high.
Yeah, your PVR is still high in a neonate. So because of this high PVR, you don't get this characteristic continuous murmur. Usually what you get is a systolic murmur. And what is the problem with this murmur? It has got a sense, the specificity of it is high, but it lacks sensitivity. And as I already said, echocardiographic signs have been shown to precede your clinical signs approximately 48 hours or 1.8 days. So this is the clinical signs we talked about. What are the echocardiographic signs? So as echo detects the signs of an hemodynamically significant PDA earlier, so echocardiography is the gold standard for the diagnosis of a PDA. So this, the one which I am showing just now is your short axis view. So you have an apical view, a plaques view, short axis view, and your suprasternal view and subcostal. These are the five views you get in echo. So in case of PDA, in short axis view, parasternal short axis, so PSACs. In parasternal short axis view, what you can see is that you can appreciate the aorta. You have the LA. Then you have the RA. You have the, between RA and RV, you have the tricuspid valve. You have the RV. From the RV, what originates? Your pulmonary artery. Normally what happens? Pulmonary artery originates and it divides it into RPA, LPA. If there is a ductus, in addition to your RPA and LPA, you can get a third limb. This third limb is your ductus or PDA. So how do you diagnose it? You put color. So you put the color Doppler, and what you will see in the color Doppler? This blue flow is pulmonary artery. So conventionally in echocardiography, when you put Doppler, the color, the probe, so you're keeping the probe up. This is the probe side. Any flow which is away from the probe is blue. Any flow which is towards the probe is red, BARP. That's the acronym which they use. Blue away, red towards. So PDA, what is the direction which we talked about? Left to right shunt. So because the direction of the flow is from left to right, it will appear as a red jet on your color Doppler. That is, the flow will be towards the probe. So this is how you diagnose PDA. So in visually, you can see, sometimes you can see three limb. You may be able to appreciate. But on putting the color Doppler, you are confirmed that you have a red jet. This red jet is your PDA. And then, so this classically, what this appearance is called, three-legged stool appearance. So this, so you have to just... imagination should be, you should have stretched it. So you have the aortic root, that's the base. Then from there, from the artery, you can see three limbs, RPA, LPA, and you have the third limb, which is connecting from the descending aorta to the pulmonary artery. So since your flow is from the aorta to pulmonary artery, it is towards the probe. That is why it is appearing as red jet compared to your blue jets of the other two limbs. Now, is there any way where you can have this three leg and the color jet be blue? Any case, any condition in neonate? you are not getting a red jet, but you have three. You are able to visualize three limbs, and on seeing the Doppler, you can see it's only a blue. There is no red jet. Reversal of shunt happens later. Which is the condition where there is right to left shunt in any unit through the
Doppler? Stenosis.
Huh?
Severe pulmonary stenosis.
Severe pulmonary stenosis. Okay, I'm not talking about a heart disease condition. Common condition you get in mass babies. Meconium aspiration.
PPHN.
Yeah. That's it. So in persistent pulmonary hypertension of the newborn, what happens is your PVR is high. What is PPHN? There is failure of the PVR to come down. Your PVR is still high. So there will be shunting from the right to left. So the color will be again away from the probe. Although there is an extra limb, the color will be blue only. So this is a condition where you the Doppler, you will not get this red jet. But typically in a PDA of a preterm, the flow will be from left to right, and you diagnose it by seeing the red jet on your Doppler. Okay, no confusion. And you measure the size of the ductus from here. That is from the point of max. You usually measure it near the origin of the pulmonary artery. So you put on your calipers, and then you measure this ductal size. This is your ductal size. Now, the second thing I was describing was direction of the shunt. What is the shunt direction? So I told that it could be right to left or left to right. Right to left, you typically see in PPHN. Left to right, you get in our ductus. So here you can see is that the one which I was talking about. The jet, the color of the jet is blue. So typically it can, you can happen it in a day one newborn. Before the PVR is still high, the ductus has not started to close. There you can see that initially the flow, the direction of the flow will be right to left. Gradually it shifts to left to right. So again, in a case of Doppler, it is blue will be away toward blue color will show right to left shunt. And once you put the M mode, you can see that the one which is below your line, this is your right to left, and the one which is above is left to right. So these are the, so after you did an echo, you saw some red jet, you measured the size. So you got to know that there is some PDA. Now, how do you measure whether it is hemodynamically significant or not? So the whole point is whether it is, so typically you say, is it HSPDA or not? Hemodynamically significant PDA or not? So what are the pointers of a hemodynamically significant PDA? So just diagnosing a red jet in echo is not enough. We need to know whether it will cause trouble to us or not, because I told you it can either be a neutral bystander or it can cause trouble to you. So you have to know whether it will cause trouble to us or not. That you measure by knowing the hemodynamic significance. So how to know the hemodynamic significance? So you measure the pattern of flow. So here you can see two patterns of blood flow. The first one, you can see that there is a peak jet, then in diastole the flow is very less. The second diagram, you can see that peakness is present more or less throughout. You don't have that sharp peak and the slope. It's almost like a broad flow. Na? So the first pattern is called pulsatile pattern or a non-restrictive pattern, which shows it is an unrestricted PDA, that you have a PDA which is not going to close. The second thing is this pattern is called, restricted PDA, or the PDA is about to get close. And in both cases, you can see that the predominant flow is above, left to right, rather than right to left. So first you measure the ductal size. Second, you look at the direction of the shunt and what is the pattern of flow. Is it a restrictive flow pattern or is it an unrestrictive flow pattern? So this is a restrictive flow pattern. This is an unrestrictive flow pattern. And third hemodynamic significant parameters, which is very commonly used. So main problem with this echo is that you have so many findings of HSPDA on echo. So the echo which I do will be different from what Chanil does. So inter-observer variability is very much there in case of echo. And among the inter-observer variability, one of the variable which has got more correlation with when two people does is LA by AO ratio. So what you do is you measure the ratio between your left atrium and aorta. So this, the view which I am just showing is your plaques view. The one three-legged stool view is short axis view. The next view is posterior parasternal long axis view or plaques view, where you can see that it's the view is just like a cut banana, cross-sectional cut banana. And the PSAX view, typically they call a cross-sectionally cut apple. So here the posterior longitudinal axis view, it's just like a banana which you cut cross-sectionally, and you can see that. So this is your left atrium. From LA, you have the mitral valve, left ventricle. From the left ventricle, you can see the aorta which is originating, and you have the RV. So in all these views, you don't get to see all the chambers. All the chambers you can only see in the apical view. In long axis as well as short axis, you can't see the four chambers. In the long axis, you can see LA, LV, aorta, and vessel as well as RV. So you can diagnose VSDs and all in this view. So here what you do is you take this view, you measure, press M mode, and you try to measure the LA, that is the left atrium, upon the aorta view, aorta ratio. And if the ratio is more than 1.5, then you call it as a hemodynamically significant PDA characteristic. So this, again, it is a feature of pulmonary overcirculation. Why does LA by AO ratio increase in case of PDA? So the pulmonary flooding, this entire blood is coming back to your LA. So your LA and LV will be overloaded. It will dilate. So there will be increased LA by AO ratio. So other parameters which they usually, you just remember the names. In discuss detail, we can discuss some other day. One is LA by AO ratio. Second, LV by AO ratio. Then you have something called E by A ratio, where you calculate the ratio of the early diastolic filling as well as the late diastolic filling. And fourth, you have intraventricular relaxation time. So what happens if the ductus is significantly patent is that there will be pulmonary overcirculation, pulmonary flooding, your LA, LV will be dilated. So LA by AO ratio will be more than 1.5. LV by AO ratio will be more than 2.2:1. Your E by A ratio will be less than 1. And intraventricular relaxation time. So what happens is that after a diastole, there is a brief phase of intraventricular relaxation where all of your, if you remember your first year anatomy, where your mitral valve is also closed as well as your aortic valve also closed before your systole. There is, at the end of the diastole, you have this intraventricular relaxation time. Now what happens is in PDA, flooding, LA, LV is overflooded. This time is reduced. The more serious the ductus, the more less will be the time. So in case of severe ductus, the intraventricular relaxation time will be less than 40. So these four generally they take as hallmark of pulmonary overcirculation. That is LA by AO increased, LV by AO increased, E by A ratio more than 1, and your IVRT less than 40. So first we calculated the ductal size and the direction of the flow from the short axis view. Then we took the long axis view and calculated the features of pulmonary overcirculation. Now, what is the thing which I said? Simultaneously with overcirculation, you have systemic hypoperfusion when you have a significant ductus. So what are the signs of a systemic hypoperfusion? How do you know whether there is systemic hyperperfusion? So typically you get in mothers on Dopplers, you can see babies. So there is reversal or flow or absent diastolic flow, umbilical. So we are worried about starting feeds, right? In case of less than, particularly less than 35. Why we are worried? Because splanchnic circulation is compromised. Same thing happens postnatally if there is a ductus. What happens? There will be steal of blood from the splanchnic circulation. So how do you measure this systemic hyperperfusion? So you keep your echo or the ultrasound probe in the abdomen in the midline and you slightly tilt it. You look for IVC, right? IVC collapsibility or distensibility. Just you look simultaneously slightly to the right. If you tilt, you can visualize the vertebra. Then you have the abdominal aorta and then you can see the vessels. The first one originating is your celiac trunk from the aorta. The next branch you can see is SMA. So just like IVC collapsibility, you just slightly tilt it to the other side, you can see the abdominal aorta and you can see the celiac axis as well as the SMA trunk which is originating. And then you again put color Doppler. And after putting the color Doppler, so this is the normal finding. What is the normal? Systole, there is a flow. Diastole, there is a flow. Systole, diastole. What happens here? Absent end-diastolic flow. And what happens in the third picture? Reversal. So this shows that there is a PDA with a feature of systemic hyperperfusion. So same thing you apply in the middle cerebral artery also. So it shows this ductal steal. You're stealing from the systemic circulation and you're supplying it to the pulmonary circulation. So in the case of echo, you have basically three findings. One is your ductal size. You measure in the short axis view. you notice the direction of the flow and how is the pattern. Is it a restrictive pattern or a unrestrictive pattern? Second, you have feature of pulmonary overcirculation. Your LA by AO ratios, LV by AO ratios, just names, at least the names you should know. And third, you have the systemic hyperperfusion where you see the SMA and you put the Doppler and see. So this is the summary of echo parameters of an HSPDA. So I think it will be difficult to grasp everything at a stance because you should have some idea about the basics of echo. So, but still you can at least know this can, everyone can ask you as a question is what are the echocardiographic parameters of an HSPDA? So what will you say? So first the ductal size. So in case of moderate to severe, the ductal size will be more than 1.5. That is why we have chosen a cutoff of 1.5 mm as a size for a significant PDA. So suppose someone asks you what are the features of an HSPDA? So the ductal size of more than 1.5, your LA by AO ratio of more than 1.5, your IVRT of less than 40, and there is diastolic reversal, either an absent or a reversal of flow in your abdominal aorta or celiac trunk. So the ductus arteriosus size and flow pattern, the features of pulmonary overcirculation, and the feature of systemic hyperperfusion. So just remember the pathophysiology, same thing you are looking for in echo. Okay. So this is the one which I just told only. So what are the features of an HSPDA? So duct diameter more than 1.5, velocity of the duct less than 2, LA by AO more than 1.5, V by A more than 1, IVRT less than 40. Now the interesting thing is that when the duct becomes significant, the velocity is actually very less. So you can just imagine if between this room and that room, suppose there is a big hole, will the flow be faster or slow? And suppose a small hole. So in case of a small hole, the jet of flow will be very rapid. So in case of a closing ductus, you actually get a bigger ductal velocity. Whereas in case of a large unrestricted duct, the ductal velocity usually will be less than 2 millimeters per second. So these are all the echocardiographic parameters of a PDA. Now, what is the problem? We already discussed if the prolonged PDA is patent prolonged, the assisted ventilation will get prolonged, increased risk of pulmonary hemorrhage, BPD, NEC, everything, which we discussed only, okay? However, an important point is that although we are postulating that pulmonary overcirculation will lead to that, systemic hyperperfusion will lead to this, studies have not found a causal relationship between this, all these diseases and a PDA. So because there are so many confounding factors, in the preterm you get n number of other factors also, sepsis, the amount of fluid you give, so many factors comes into play. So by studies, it's very actually difficult to get a causal relationship. But what postulated is that these are the problems. So I told that in less than 30 weeks, the PDA usually troubles us. So is it necessary to screen the PDA for all? Or all newborns for that matter? No. So the clinical signs usually appear later than the echocardiographic signs, and the clinical signs are less sensitive. That is why the role of echo comes, which is the gold standard. You can also do a phase contrast MRI, but it is not feasible in your extremely preterm or a sick preterm infant. So we'll leave it for the time being. So what people have done is that this is a study which they tried to do association between early screening for PDA and in-hospital mortality among extreme preterm. So your extreme preterm is your less than 28 weeks. So in less than 28 weeks, what they did was Rose et al. He did early screening for all and then associated with it in-hospital mortality among extreme preterm. And what the finding was that if you do early screening for all extreme preterm, it was associated with lower in-hospital mortality as well as lower pulmonary hemorrhage incidence. So in case of extreme preterms, you can consider universal screening. But again, this was only an observational study, so not an RCT. But in general, in extreme preterms, people do universal screening. And so first we discussed about echo. Now a brief about biomarkers. People have found correlation between biomarkers. The typical biomarkers are the N-type BNP and the B-type BNP. So you have correlation between the B-type natriuretic peptide levels and echocardiographic parameters in preterm infants. So what they have seen that increased BNP and N-terminal BNP correlate with presence of moderate size shunt. But again, it cannot replace echo. So you don't have a facility for echo. You can't send BNP and say, okay, BNP is elevated. This baby might be having it. Just as a corroborative, you can do a BNP or NT-proBNP. Again, its feasibility, costly, availability, everything comes into play. But there is some role of biomarker. And what the people have actually done with this biomarkers is that the people studied troponin T, N-terminal proBNP, and tried to develop a PDS scoring system. So what's our problem? We know there is a duct, but we cannot predict whether it will cause trouble to us or whether it will just stand as a neutral bystander and closes off spontaneously. So you cannot predict on a day two whether it will close spontaneously or whether it will cause trouble. So what people, they try to develop a scoring system so that they can identify those infants with a PDA who are at a greater risk of poor neurodevelopmental outcome. So, what they did was they devised 2-3 parameters and devised a scoring system. And they predicted that if the score is so-and-so, the baby is high risk, likely to get problems with PDA. But again, many units don't use this. Just know that there is some biomarkers there and there is a scoring system. Okay. So in diagnosis, you have clinical echocardiography, which is the gold standard, and you have a biomarkers, which just adds on. Now, the most important decision you have is whether to treat or not. First, you have to decide whether to treat or not. And if you decide to treat, how do you treat? So, to treat or not, we'll discuss. So, what are the treatment options if you decide to treat? You have drugs. Second, surgical. Third, you also have transcatheter device closure. That one typically which is done for older children. The older children, if there is duct, you usually do transcatheter device closure, right? Nowadays, even in preterm infants, people have started doing transcatheter device closure. So you have drugs, you have surgery, and then you have transcatheter device closure. And the next thing is you have some 2-3 options when to treat. So here you can have three modalities of treatment: prophylactic treatment, early targeted treatment, and symptomatic treatment. So in prophylactic treatment, what did they do? Extreme preterm bone, day one, you treat. Whether there is whether the duct is going to be opening up or it will cause problem, you're not worried about anything, just baby bone, you treat. That is called prophylactic treatment. What is early targeted treatment? There you go. So you do an echo, you see there is an HSPDA, then you treat. Symptomatic, no echo, you wait for the clinical symptoms to appear, then you treat. So you have basically three approaches: prophylactic, early targeted, and symptomatic treatment. Now, whether to treat or not, that is the biggest question which is still unresolved. So no one can clear cut or with confidence say you treat or not treat, because the pro treatment group, the people who say that you should treat, what do they argue? The one which we discussed. So if you leave the PDA like that, it will cause pulmonary edema, hemorrhage, BPD, IVH, PVL, cerebral palsy, acute kidney injury, necrotizing enterocolitis. So they'll argue that there are a hell lot of problems for the knee, so you treat. What about the anti-treatment group? So they'll say, why to treat? Anyway, majority of PDA will close off spontaneously, so wait. So spontaneous closure of PDA is one thing for argument. Second is, although you are saying that there are so many morbidities, you have not found a causal relationship. So why blame everything on PDA? So there is lack of causal relationship with morbidities. And the most important thing was that no studies yet to find a long-term improvement in neurodevelopmental outcome with treatment. So in neonatology, whatever may be the drug, they look at mainly two things. Short-term any issue, long-term any better issue. Like short-term, will it improve the short-term morbidities like IVH, PVL, BPD, NEC? And long-term, will it lead to better neurodevelopmental outcome? So the treatment with PDA has not been found to have lack of long-term benefit. So the anti-treatment group say, why to treat if there is no long-term benefit? And the side effect of the drugs which you are giving. So the pharmacological agent, some drug, anyway, it will have some side effects. So the side effect of the NSAIDs, as well as if you do a surgery, the post-op complications of surgery. So there are actually two arguments: to treat, not to treat. So this is again the trial, which is called PDA tolerate trial, which was done recently. I'll just tell you what they tried to do. So what they tried to do was less than 28 weeks gestation units with moderate to large PDA. They enrolled between 1 to 2 weeks, and they tried to assess whether there was the baby, if the PDA is getting close or the baby requires ligation or not. And what was the result? They found that early routine pharmacological treatment did not reduce the ligation, or the presence of PDA discharge and did not improve any of the outcome. And in fact, they found that higher rate of sepsis and death. This was a study which was published last year. So this is again an anti-PDA treatment type of study. But again, what I said, this study had many limitations. So the main problem with PDA is that yet the studies which say that there is no point in treating, they have many limitations. So in general, I will discuss once again. So prophylactic, I already said, you treat everything irrespective of whether they have PDA or not. Early targeting, you do echo within 72 hours, identify infants with HSPDA and then treat. And suppose you identify an infant with HSPDA. We have already discussed, there is a scoring system. You also look at the PDA score, and if the score is also high, then you definitely treat. So this is the scoring system which I was talking about. I'll just rush through. So basically, the approach which most of the people nowadays use is an early targeted approach. So no one treats PDA now prophylactically. You do an echo within 48 to 72 hours. You get a feature of echo hemodynamically significant PDA. You treat. So this is the approach most, in general, majority of the units, whether in USA, India, UK, everywhere follow. So early targeted treatment, although this is not supported by evidence, people in general do early targeted treatment. So these are some of the trials which are currently ongoing, maybe which will give a better answer to us. So these large well-designed trials from around the world are evaluating whether early targeted treatment approach and using objective echocardiographic criteria should answer the question of whether attempted closure of an echo-defined moderate to large PDA before it is symptomatic, whether it will have any benefit. So trials are ongoing, but till now, with the available body of evidence, majority people do early targeted treatment. Now, why majority of the people do early targeted treatment? Because all these studies which say that you need not treat because even after treatment, there is no benefit. In all those studies, so suppose when you do a study, you have two arms. One arm you give treatment, the other arm you don't give treatment. But in all those studies, in the arm which did not give treatment also, after 2 to 3 weeks, those babies also received treatment. So we actually don't know. There are limitations with the study quality. That's the problem. So as of now, you just remember, you have a ductal, you can either do pharmacotherapy or you can do surgical management, conservative management, which we will discuss later. So pharmacotherapy, you have three options basically, and you have surgical options. Pharmacotherapy, which are the three options? So these three drugs you should know. The treatment of PDA, the most common three pharmacological options was, so the first one which was came was indomethacin. People left right were using indomethacin only. So what happened? Indomethacin, there is increased risk for GI side effects, NEC, renal failure, deranged creatinine, thrombocytopenia. So the next one came, who? Brufen. So Brufen, again, what Brufen was showed that there is less incidence of NEC as well as less incidence of transient renal insufficiency. But now more and more units are starting to use paracetamol. Why? Less side effect, equal efficacy. So you have three options, Brufen, indomethacin, PCM. Indomethacin, you can more or less say it is like obsolete. No one uses now. Either you use Brufen or you use PCM. And nowadays, majority of the Indian units, they follow paracetamol. And the dose of paracetamol is 15 mg per kg per dose, 6 hourly into 72 hours. Some people give continuously for 6 to 7 days also. So some people give for 72 hours, repeat an echo and see. Some people just give continuously for 6 days and then repeats an echo. So pharmacotherapy, you have Brufen, indomethacin, PCM. How can you do? Prophylactic, early symptomatic or late? People in general follow this one. Secondly, early 1 to 3 days, echo proven and the baby is asymptomatic. And then you have the surgical limb. So we'll not be discussing in detail about that. And some conservative strategies like fluid restriction, diuretics, increased PEEP and all, which I will discuss. So we'll just discuss about the pharmacological agents in detail little. So what you have three drugs. So you should know the mechanism of action. So I have discussed in detail the pathophysiology. So who do they target? Prostaglandin. So they target the PGHS complex. So this is again your first year biochemistry, phospholipids, arachidonic acid, PGG2, H2. So the PGHS complex, it has got a cyclooxygenase moiety and a peroxidase moiety. The Brufen and indomethacin, they are COX inhibitors, cyclooxygenase inhibitors. Whereas your paracetamol, it inhibits the peroxidase component of this PGHS complex. So this you should know, mechanism of action of these drugs. So the dosage again, indomethacin people usually don't use nowadays. So brufen you should know, 10 mg per kg per dose on day 1, 5 on day 2, 5 on day 3. 10, 5, 5. Paracetamol I have already said. So side effects, what are the side effects? Indomethacin, renal impairment, thrombocytopenia, NEC, and the contraindication is if the platelet is less than 60 or if your creatinine is deranged or if you have oliguria, you don't give indomethacin. Brufen, the side effects are more or less same, but they are less. Less incidence of NEC and less incidence of renal insufficiency. Paracetamol, in general, least side effect, but some studies have shown that it has got increased incidence of autism in childhood. Again, yet to prove. So long term, we don't know because it is just started to use only for the last 2 years. Maybe in the future studies will come. But as of now, people are trying to use paracetamol because equal efficacy, less side effects. So which drug has the highest likelihood of HSPD occlusion? Highest likelihood. Anyone from the Zoom? Well, I've slept, I think. So the drug which has got highest likelihood of HSPD is that. So this was a network systematic review and meta-analysis. So what is a systematic review? A review of RCTs, the highest body of evidence. So when you do a study, observational study, then you have the case control, the cohorts, then the RCT, and the review of RCTs here, systematic review. So people, this was actually an Indian, okay? Sauvik Mitra, he's an Indian. Association of placebo, indomethacin, brufen, and acetaminophen with closure of HSPD in preterm infants, a systematic review and meta-analysis. And what he found that 68 RCTs, so you can see the amount of studies in PDA, with 4,800 infants, and the overall PDA closure rate with pharmacological therapy, someone asked me, 2/3, 67.4%. And what it was seen that brufen, high dose brufen was associated with significant higher odds of PDA closure. And the interesting thing is the one which is highlighted in downstates. There was no significant difference in the odds of mortality, NEC or IVH with use of placebo or no treatment compared with any of the treatment modalities. So even if you don't treat, again, there is no, which we have already discussed. So still trials are currently ongoing, well-designed trials, which will give an answer to us later. So among the three, efficacy is more or less same. Least side effect, paracetamol. So some people use paracetamol, but there are many units who think that paracetamol long-term, we don't know what will happen, autism and all. So still some units use brufen. Indomethacin more or less obsolete. So pharmacological treatment option, we have only three. And what about surgical ligation? So what do? You do definitive ductus arteriosus closure. Now what is the problem with surgery? Again, you can have risk for thoracotomy, exposure to anesthesia, pneumothorax, chylothorax, infection, vocal cord paralysis, so and so. So in general, so this is again, the study which showed surgical ligation versus medical management. It was shown that ligation was associated with lower odds of mortality with no difference in long-term outcome. So as of now, what is the consensus is that surgical ligation, you reserve only those cases when you have failed your medical therapy and still the baby is having higher ventilatory requirement or you are not able to wean off, like a last resort. That is the option for surgery. So in general, what people do is you do an early targeted treatment, find a PDA, do a medical treatment. After one course, you repeat same. Repeat same. So first course paracetamol, you again do a repeat paracetamol. First course brufen, you again give a repeat course brufen. So after repeat failed medical therapy, still you see if your baby's ventilator requirement or not. So like in our ICU, we have our baby. We have given two courses, one paracetamol and brufen. After that, still the baby is on CPAP and room air, 21% FiO2. In those babies, you can maybe wait and watch because unnecessary, why to expose that baby to that surgical risk? Suppose your medical therapy is failed, baby is on ventilator, there is no other cause. The main problem which is causing for this ventilator dependency is PDA. You have contraindications to medical therapy. Then in those cases, you can consider PDA ligation. And this was transcatheter closure, which was done for older children. So nowadays, in premature infants, this possibility is being tried and complete closure was, this was studied where there's did something like 18 infants. Complete closure was achieved in all but one patient. So transcatheter closure is also now starting to come on the horizon. It's just beginning to be explored. Okay. So this is another case scenario. So in short of time, I'll just run through. So the baby, so and so at 6 hours, the baby underwent ligation. After ligation, the baby developed hypotension, which was refractory to inotropes. So this is one condition which is described post-surgery, one of the complications, post-ligation cardiac syndrome, wherein it is characterized by after surgery, the baby goes in for refractory shock. Hemodynamic instability and respiratory failure post-surgery seen in 25 to 50% cases post-ligation. And the cause is that decrease in LV afterload and increase in decrease in LV preload and increase in afterload. And so this is one of the important complication of surgery, post-ligation cardiac syndrome. Other complications which we have already discussed, and also briefly I'm mentioning about adrenal dysfunction. So it's better before to surgery, some people advise to do a baseline adrenal hormonal profile so that to assess whether the baby has got adrenal dysfunction or postoperatively it will worsen. Why? Because chronic ductal steal, like we said about compromising splenic circulation, it can chronic ductal steal, it can cause hyperperfusion of the adrenal gland also. So these are all complications of surgery. Now what about a brief about non-pharmacological strategies? Fluid intake restriction, diuretics, modulation of the flow. Fluid intake restriction, so in general, so this was a Cochrane review which assessed the evidence for fluid intake restriction, which showed that restricted fluid leads to decreased risk for PDA. So nowadays you just restrict fluid so that the baby doesn't land up in CCF. You don't restrict like 120 or 130, something like 150 to 160 ml per kg per day. Or if the baby is in CCF, you can further restrict to 120 to 100. So basically you prevent the development of CCF. Diuretics, again, the only role is CCF. Why? In older children, for PDA, you just start diuretic, right? In the preterm, the furosemide, it is known to stimulate renal synthesis of PGE2. So again, you are trying to treat PDA, but the furosemide will cause increased synthesis of PGE2 and the doctors will remain patent as such. So diuretics is only a last resort for CCF prevention. And for ventilatory strategies, basically what people advise is that you give a higher MAP, use a higher PEEP, and you use permissive hypercapnia strategy. So again, this is hypercapnia. There are no studies assessing impact. Hematocrit also maintain a high hematocrit, which will cause high systemic as well as PVR and cause decline in left right shunt. Again, evidence is not that robust. So our take home message from this is that PDA, you should know the pathophysiology and also the group of babies where you should be worried, mostly the less than 30 weaker group. Second, the decision of the treatment for PDA, it should be individualized. It's not like blanket treatment for all. So particularly in extreme preterm, less than 28 weeks, you do a targeted, early targeted approach wherein you do an echo within 72 hours. If you find an HSPDA, you treat. Less than 28. More than 28 or more than 30 week baby, it is always better to follow a wait and watch or a conservative policy. So available evidence does not support the prophylactic or the pre-symptomatic approach. Expectant treatment of HSPD seems to be the most reasonable. And medical management, you have three drug options, indomethacin, brufen, and paracetamol, which are equally effective in closing the PDA. But the least side effects is seen with paracetamol. And you reserve the surgical closure for those neonates who have failed your medical therapy and have got echocardiographic evidence of a large duct, or the baby is having an ongoing significant oxygen as well as ventilator requirement. So only in those group of babies you try surgical closure. Rest you go with the medical management. Three options. Better prefer paracetamol because least side effect. To treat or not treat, still a debate, but in less than 28 week extreme preterm, you can follow a early targeted approach where you do an echo within 72 hours and then treat. Okay. So any questions from the audience or from the Zoom? Okay. So again, pharmacology is like PDF. Suppose you have a PDF just developing CCF. First you do fluid restriction. Restrict something to 2/3 of your normal maintenance. Give diuretics. Then try see whether you have already exercised your medical management or not. if you have already given two courses, no point in giving. But you have not still not given, you can try medical management first. Always medical management, if there are no contraindications, do medical management first and then do surgical management. Now, another important point which I failed to say is that in medical management also, the probability of closing ductus with a medical management is high when you treat early. That is like less than 2 weeks. Once the baby is older, this prostaglandin, it is seen that the prostaglandin is not the problem. Once the baby is like 3 to 4 weeks, there you have the chance for success with medical management is less, but still as a first option, you always exercise medical, if not given prior. Try a first course. If you have already given a first course of PCM, this time try PCM again, or this time try Brufen. After you try Brufen, medical management, still you are not able to, and the baby should be ventilator dependent. It's not like baby is room air or on CPAP, you can wait. Okay? If you have exercised all your medical options, still refractory CCS, fluid restriction, diuretic, medical management, still no improvement, in those cases, maybe you can consider surgical option.
Sir, one more doubt, sir.
Okay.
The preterm baby failed medical therapy for two times, sir, and have a large duct. Then when we will refer the baby for a surgical closure, sir, on antifailure drugs? Baby on antifailure drugs, sir.
So that's again a difficult scenario. So in general, what I discussed already. So if you have already exercised your medical option, you just assess what is the current situation of the baby. Is the baby ventilator requirement or not?
No, sir.
The baby is in room air.
Yes, sir. In room air.
In room air, if the baby is on room air, maybe you can continue the medical management and see. You continue with your fluid restriction and anti-CCF measures. You wait. Wait to see if spontaneous closure happens. Suppose your baby worsens, like the baby requires suddenly, a room air baby suddenly started having ventilator requirement.
Then, okay, sir.
With CCF, if you have already treated twice with medically, it's better to consider surgical option.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Vijay?
Sir, one more question.
Yeah.
Sir, whether elevated renal parameters are a contraindication for paracetamol therapy in a ventilated neonate?
Okay. So in general, elevated renal parameters you consider as contraindications for basically for intomethacin and Brufen. Paracetamol, mainly the toxicity is for hepatotoxicity rather than renal toxicity. So IV paracetamol you can give.
Any more questions? You can unmute yourself and ask, or you can post it in the chat box.
Hemodynamically insignificant PDA, wait and watch. Wait and watch. You echo. So as such, the schedule of echo, suppose you do a first echo within 72 hours. In first echo, if you see HSPDA, you have to repeat after 24 hours. Even if you don't see a HSPDA, you have to repeat. So in general, the protocol many units follow is less than 30 weeks. First echo, 24 plus or minus 12 hours. That is day 1 to day 2. Repeat echo at 24 hours. Repeat echo on day 7. But in case of more than 28 weeks, like 29 week onwards, if your first echo is normal, do a second one 24 hours later, again normal, no need to follow. Because suppose your baby will be in room air, you are not finding any clinical feature, no hypodynamic precordium, no white pulse pressure, no precordial pulsations. So the baby is also otherwise in room air. He's a very well growing preterm on full feet. There is no need to do routine echo. Once that initial phase has passed, that is first week has passed. After first week, one of the main culprit for a reopening of PDA is sepsis. So PDA might have closed, your 1 week have elapsed. But suppose the baby develops late onset sepsis on third week, that time PDA might reopen. And again, you have to have a suspicion for, if you see white pulse pressure, tachycardia or bounding pulses, then you do an echo. So after first week in general, you don't do routine echoes to detect PDA. You assume that if at all it is there, it is non-HSPDA, and I'm not going to do anything for a non-HSPDA. So why to do an echo?
So one more question. Will a PDA reopen and if open, whether repeat medical management is enough.
So again, PDA can reopen, and one, as I just said, one of the main culprit for a reopening of PDA is sepsis. So what happens in sepsis? Again, there will be release of this inflammatory mediators, these prostaglandin and everything, which will again cause the closed ductus before anatomical closure. The anatomical closure, once it happens, it is irreversible. But in preterms, it happens very late. So we don't know when it will close. So in that case, once a sepsis happens, there is chance for reopening for PDA. So again, once a PDA reopens, again, you have option or provision to do medical management. So first, always medical, then surgical. That should be the take home.
Were there any more questions? If there are no more questions, then we can move the class.
Wind up
the class. So your class was very informative. Thank you.
Thank you all for the patient listening.